La Cosecha, dedicated to La Madre Tierra and the farm workers who work rain, shine, heat wave, burning wildfire or pandemic to harvest food for a society that doesn't value them.
Yes. I'm kidding. Welcome to the 2020 virtual theater stage for the 13th annual Life is Living Festival. My name is Ashley Smiley. I am one of the co-curators for this year's festival and for the theater stage given to us graciously by Youth Speaks and CalShakes. I got to really get to dig in and work with Tierra Allen and Brittany White. Much love and shout outs to them. Before we get any further, I would really, really like to honor the fact that we are on Ramatush and Yalamu Ohlone territory, as well as honor the fact that we would typically be in Defermery Park, aka Lil Bobby Hutton Park, which was a central base for the Black Panther Party of Self-Defense. Oakland, stand all the way up. Again, my name is Smiley, and I'm just really blessed and thankful to be able to take this time with you and investigate our relationship with time. This message for us today and the theme for the entire theater stage is our time is sacred, aka this time is sacred, aka I got time. We got time to look at our healing, to look at our education, to look at our family, to look at our connections, to look at art and the way that it moves us. Yes, yes, yes.
Blessings, you know, like that's what we are to each other, and we just have to recall that. We have to reclaim that. And so I'm just incredibly blessed to be able to sit in this space and have this conversation with you. And Life is Living is the way that we continue to remind each other of what actually matters, that we are all humans in the experience, right? And we are spirits. We are spirits in the reality. We have to remember that the human part is the experience. The reality is that we're spirits. And so Life is Living is about that spirit. It's about really bringing that to fore and being clear about our right to joy and our right to fill this life with each other's essence, you know. So every time that I've ever been involved in Life is Living, it's always been a recapturing of that truth. So for me to be a part of this again, thank you. And thank you for making this happen.
Ask you their question, what time is it on the clock of the world?
It's the time that it's always been. I don't feel that the time has shifted. I really love Octavia Butler, so I'm gonna get into it right now. And I love physics. And if we really truly are in touch with time, it's always the right time. It's always the right time. It's the right time to step into the purpose. So time is now and it's right. It's always for me.
How could we shift to having a more healing, like liberatory, expansive relationship with the times that we're in and just time in general?
Everyone has their own perspective on how we're, you know, positioned in relationship to each other, relationship to the elements, and relationship to everything. I call that our cosmological worldview. My cosmological worldview is based upon the acceptance of change, that change is ever present. And that really keeps me clear. As soon as I get caught up in this notion that this is a static reality, that it will always be this way, I have to double back on that truth, that change is the constant. And I'm constantly in change, I'm in flux internally myself, in my cellular structure. There's always this drive to keep moving. And so I let that guide me, even in the moments when I don't feel that I can move, that I don't feel that I have weight in a conversation, in an experience. I remind myself of my cosmological worldview, which also doesn't fear death, which doesn't, I defy that fear of death. I don't understand the concept when we know that it's a truth. For me, it's also part of the change, that I will not die, so to speak, but that I'm part of this grand change and I'm being compelled toward that as well. So I am living this lifetime to earn my death. So for people who are dispirited by these truths, it's really important to figure out your cosmological worldview. You know, my guides are James Baldwin, who reminded me that we fill our lives with temples and we fill our lives with synagogues and churches and these structures that compress and oppress, and that all of the ways in which we experience homophobia and transphobia and sexism, misogyny, racism, colorism, ableism, sizeism, is really this feeble attempt to escape the truth, which is that we're here to be in this process and that death is inevitable. Death is part of the process. And rather than creating structures to keep lying to ourselves about it, we should embrace each other. We should embrace each other's lives. We should embrace our lives. We should honor this. So my cosmological worldview is the way that I look at time. I am part of this great spirit change, this great ever transforming truth. It will never always be this bad. It's eternal, and I thank you for being in it with me, and I love you and I adore you, and you deserve peace and joy and love, and we will continue to be angelic hellraisers. I appreciate you. Is there anything that you wanted to share that you didn't get a chance to share?
Well, just in what you were last sharing, I just saw you talked about, you know, if I can paraphrase, or maybe actually recall the words, like a cosmic push. And then you brought it to your, you know, to the fact that you have birth, and just wanted to say that definitely birth is what came to my mind when you mentioned cosmic push. And so and think, you know, thinking about what else could this pressure be? What else? Just appreciating that as also another way to maybe make sense of some feelings that also then are about, this is moving towards life. Even it's everything that it's a push towards life, and how can, you know, for myself, you know, just speaking for me, feel that and feel into that something else is being birthed right now. And you know, so sometimes, like, you know, I just got moved. But like,
yeah, right. This, I felt it,
you know,
felt
and the squeeze and the push, and yeah, something else is gonna dawn.
Oh my gosh, I'm gonna continue to think of that pressure in the context that you shared it, you know, and that I wasn't alone in that process, that pressure and the cosmic push. Yeah, right now we are in it, and it's okay for some of us to really feel like the pressure right now. I need to rest. Mm-hmm. Childbirth, let me tell you, there were a lot of moments of rest. It would not have happened if there had not been those moments like, okay, you know what? I'm not even sure that it's okay for me to rest, but I'm gonna rest. Just like, the urge is telling me all the things, I just can't even describe it. This is gonna happen, rest. You know, some of us are pushed to exhaustion and then are forced to rest. That's okay too. I'm just saying we're doing what we can in the way that we can to make sense of this human experience as these expansive spirits caught in these corporeal meat sacks. And also gifted with all of the other energies and the other forms that exist here that are all the same creation. We are all the same creative energy. That's a mind-blowing thing. It's okay. Push. That's all right. That's all right. I love it. Thank you for letting this ease into all of the nooks and crannies of the unknown too. I felt like there are a lot of unspoken truths here, and I can feel those unspoken truths that were just whizzing by like, no, it's okay. You don't have to say that. Someone else is going to do that. Someone else. It's okay. Someone else can do that. Yeah. Yeah.
It's definitely something that I do think about also. I mean, with these devices, you know, like I said, you know, what needs to get spoken in a different way, considering these devices and what, you know, who's made them and all of that. So mm-hmm. try to move with like mindfulness and intention rather than fear, but also, yeah. you know, there's things we're also moving within things that we didn't create. So.
That's right. Well, I enjoy the shift and I'm grateful. I'm grateful to be shifting with you.
And me as well. Just want to say that I also adore and love you. And when it's safe, would love to, you know, give you one of these if it felt right, for sure.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. You'll see me. I'll be out. When you're out, I'll probably be out somewheres. Masked up. Definitely.
But masked up with clean hands.
Yes, that part. Let's save each other. Let's save each other for this journey, if we can. All right, my loves.
All right, Kim, thank you so much.
Thank you, honey.
Yeah, and I will, you know. Thank you. And, you know, some of the, you know, little bit of paperwork and things like will come your way. And we'll also, you know, give you information so you can, you know, share with community. We are really hoping that all of life is living. And then in particular, the zone that I've been working with Smiley to curate, you know, we hope it feels like a gift to everybody.
It is always such a blessing to be able to hear Ken speak, like the genius of their being, right? And then also much shout out to my co-curator, Tierra Allen, for holding that interview. It was really important to also see her and her processing and them processing together. Yes, it is so important for us to ask ourselves, what is our cosmological worldview? And how is that affecting us in this time? Really investigate that, y'all. What is our cosmological worldview? What are we thinking about? What is happening with us right now in our spirit and in this time, right? Yes, ask the question. I know something that has been heavy on my mind personally is acknowledging the work of my ancestors and my responsibility for the present and future, not just for myself, you know what I'm saying, but also for my community and the people around me. And also this beautiful land that I'm on. And you know something that's really gonna help us even sink further into that? The next piece that we have coming up, titled Persist. Now, Persist is an excerpt from Genevieve Jessee's new play, The Rendering Cycle, which was directed by the new artistic director of Lorraine Hansberry Theater, Margot Hall, and performed by Kathleen Ridley and Champagne Hughes. And at the heart of The Rendering Cycle is how to preserve and protect what is most precious in the face of peril, century after century. The excerpt Persist centers on the support and connection Black women hold as divine duty to seize the present as our moment. Oh, let me say that again. At the heart of The Rendering Cycle is how to preserve and protect what is most precious in the face of peril, century after century. The excerpt Persist centers on the support and connection Black women hold as divine duty to seize the present as our moment. To seize the present as our moment. Let's get into it.
Nobody turn me round, ain't gonna let nobody turn me round. I'm gonna keep on walking, Lord, keep on talking, Lord, marching to the freedom land. Ain't gonna let no sheriff turn me round, ain't gonna let no sheriff turn me round. I'm gonna keep on walking, Lord, keep on talking, Lord, marching to the freedom land.
Yes. Oh, that message is so deep. Black women always out here saving people's lives, doing the hard work, doing the duty. We need to, again, take this time to not just say her name, you know what I mean? Because that's a hashtag that happens after we have lost a precious black woman. We need to be giving the flowers right now. We need to be making sure that people understand that black women are necessary, magical, caregivers, caretakers, the people who really birth this nation and move it forward. Look at Black Lives Matter. Look at the women of the Black Panther Party. Look at the Tamika Mallorys of the world. We're out here on the front lines all the time without getting our proper due, right? That's something that we and we do it willingly, y'all. Selflessly. Something else that persists really just put on my heart, though, is our necessity to vote. We need to vote. We need to vote. We need to vote, y'all. So, if you're confused about, you know, whether or not you're registered to vote or not, you can go to registertovote.ca.gov. Check your registration status, make sure that it's all correct, that it's updated, that you can turn in your ballot, turn in that ballot now, okay? After October 5th, you could go ahead and drop it right there where it needs to go, or you could drive it up a couple weeks before and or go to a polling place on November 3rd, but you need to do that. And if you want to know about the propositions, right? Because you're a little bit confused. You're like, what does a yes mean? What does a no mean? Pass, false, true, what? I don't understand. Then you can go to votersguide.sos.ca.gov, and it will give you a quick reference guide as well as tell you the pros, the cons, the fors, ands, against, rebuttals, go into detail and help you make informed decisions. That is something that we need to do. That is something that we need to persistently make sure people understand is a necessity at this time. We really need to go ahead and get this super spreader and death eater about the White House. Feel me? Let's do that. So now that we've had that moment, we're gonna take another little switch into some dedicated and intentional mindfulness with the wonderful Sarai Bordeaux, who's going to take us into prayers in time. Okay, prayers in time, that's what we need to restore ourselves in time. Sarai Bordeaux has just finished her master's degree from San Francisco State University. Yep, I did that too. Go Gators. And has also been working with the People's Kitchen Collective. You know about them. They are the folks that do free breakfast for us every single year with them good, them heart-shaped little pieces of cornbread, y'all, with the honey and then they got the coconut milk grits, okay, but the collard greens. Y'all know about it. And that has been honoring the Black Panther Party's free breakfast program, which began in Oakland because time, because cycles, because honoring our ancestors, because honoring the work of our ancestors and bringing it into the future. This is what we're talking about. Yes, yes. She also, though, while doing that work, likes her quiet time, you know? And she also likes lizards, you know? And wants to write more poems in the future. So let's give her our undivided attention and our love as she takes us through this prayer in time. Thank you.
everybody. My name is Sarai, and I would love to share a prayer poem with y'all. Before I start, I just want to say I'm so grateful for this experience, and I'm so grateful for everybody that has worked so hard to put Life is Living on this year. All the volunteers, all the collaborators, everybody who's submitted a piece. I'm grateful for each and every one of y'all, all the people watching. Existence in this moment seems really tough, so I'm just so grateful to share this space with y'all. Glittering goddess of abundance and healing, mother, father, divine, slower changer of space and time, peace of my mind, peace of my mind, with galaxies for areola, in consistent labor, bodies of seas and valleys, gender non-conforming God, vast keeper of gems hidden in ritual, mirror of goodness, thank you for shining our way today. And also, if I may, I have some bones to pick, bones like divination, advice for the future, not like picking in anger. God, tell us 2020 is still a vision year, that there is no problem with me or with you. Help us find a familial conjuring to understand this human problem we are having, this bruise that's developed over time, in making time to steep my spirit in questions I need to convene in divine time to answer. Take time, real time, to answer. God, slather our healing like a balm. God of pocket crystals and amber oils, how in these bodies do we find sacred spaces to come home to? Make it safe for others to do so too, if only in our own bodies for now. Though at times I remain confused, I'm seeing signs that you and I, that we are telling the same time. Things are matching up, syncing up, clearing up, just in time. It's about time. Our intuitions have been waiting. Good, good, gracious God of bare feet and also every shoe, protect our steps. Help us befriend our shadows. Bend our time towards thriving. Help us understand our worthiness, even under covers of worries. God, send angels to sit on our shoulders, ancestors to whisper in our ears, share breakfast with us, send the stardust through our bookshelves, introduce the spirits to different words on the page, come back for us. Endless advisor, show us the meaning of dimension through petals of flowers and new growth on houseplants. Teach us through expansion, cultivation, through the seeping out of stuck emotion, goddess of the pen, of dance, of passion, of a slight smile that comes in flow this time around. Let us get to know ourselves for ourselves, our spirit's sake, for our ancestral sake. It is possible for us to create what we are imagining. Give ourselves time to be imagining and our babies time to be imagining. Right now is that time. Unconditional creator, guide us in ritual that connects us. In affirmation, in a finding, one that happens over a lifetime, in this lifetime, help us recognize our calling, that we are chosen to hold on to the magic still coming. It's a great time. Right now is a great time to tumble the tower. Learn this iteration of that lesson. I'm guessing, since we have no way of knowing when time will be up, it is okay to wear ourselves proudly. Remind us that it is okay to wear ourselves proudly. Steal back our time from those who would have shackled even hours of the day. How many hours of the day can you call yours? Can we call ours? We need a liberation of dates and times, not like on holidays, but like today. Today is every day, potentially. Like, what if we were free all of the time? What if we were free all of the time? That is the manifestation we are working on. That time be ours. That time be mine and yours, God of ripe mango and peach jam. Help us remember that every space and every time is ours, that we ourselves are each other's, that we are infinite like time, sacred like time, limitless like time, that we ourselves our time. In the name of our beloved Oakland, California, of my goddess and your goddess too, our forever precious spaces and times, I pray. Ashe. Thank you so much. Y'all take care and be safe out there. Bye.
Again, thank you so much, Sarai. Thank you so much, Sarai, for making sure that we take a legitimate and intentional moment to sit in prayer and mindfulness and reflect on this time, as well as manifest for the future. So important and so very necessary. We've been hearing a lot from the Finbody folks, right? We started out with our Latina homegirls of La Mezcla bringing us in strong. And then we delved into Finbody folks, you know, Ken and Tierra, but also hearing from Ellen, Britt, Star, and Sarai. And now it would only be right if we also took a moment to honor the male-bodied, and in particular, the Black and brown male-bodied folks in our community, and hear a little bit about what's going on with them. So before we get into a dope interview that I was able to have with my brother SPULU, I would like to introduce the next two pieces that are coming up, as well as the artists who are behind them. So the first person that I would like to introduce is SPULU. SPULU is a creative mover, storyteller, dance maker, body historian, fashion designer, and interdisciplinary performing artist from Chochino Ohlone land, Oakland, California. Their work has been showcased all over the world in response to all the social issues facing Pacific Islanders worldwide. SPULU uses arts and movement as a form of resistance and protest. His recent work was featured in last year's Levi's Pride 2019 international campaign, and he also co-created a Nike shoe, Nike Oak, which sold out the first few days of launch. Because that's how we do. SPULU is currently working as a fashion designer from his home studio while serving as a birth advocate with Pacific Islander doulas, Mama Pacifica, in the San Francisco Bay Area. Love you, SPULU. Love you so much. Yes. Also, who we're going to be hearing about and hearing from is Dazié Grego-Sykes and Dyke Lee, aka Chibueze Crouch, and their piece, My Black Male Body. So Dazié is an Oakland-based performance artist and activist. He is a graduate of the Experimental Performance Institute of New College of California and holds an MFA in Interdisciplinary Arts and Writing from the California Institute of Integral Studies. Put respect on them degrees. Currently, he's touring two solo plays, Am I a Man and Niggeroo, while promoting his spoken word album titled Make Me Black. Right now, what we're going to see is Dazié reading from the collection of poetry and prose, Black Faggotry, which was published by Nomadic Press in early 2020. Chibueze Crouch is a Nigerian-American performance and teaching artist born on Pawtucket land in Danbury, Connecticut. Currently living on Chichenyo Ohlone land in Oakland, California. Her creative practice studies theater and ritual, examining diasporic longing and constructions of queer identity through masquerade, song, text, and live performance. An RHE fellowship recipient, Chibueze has performed at Counterpulse, the National Queer Arts Festival, Crowded Fire, Stanford University, BAMFA, and more. Her work is a slow trickle of blood sliding down your forearm, the sweetest juice of an overripe fruit. You almost don't notice it until it stains your good shirt. Then you can never forget where it came from. Oop, you better talk about your work the way it is, girl. Do that. So we're gonna be seeing My Black Male Body from Chibueze and Dazié, but first we're gonna jump into SPULU and his piece, Black versus Blues. And Black versus Blues, let me tell you about it. Debuted in 2014 after the killing and murder of Oscar Grant and Alex Nieto by police officers. Both Oscar and Alex's story hits home for SPULU because Alex Nieto was a classmate of his at City College in San Francisco. And Oscar Grant's story hit home because it happened in his hometown of Oakland, in the Fruitvale District. Dance and movement is SPULU's form of resistance to political, environmental, economic, and social issues all around the world. And this piece is a response to police violence that is still happening all over the world. Let's get into it.
This time. Like, how are you defining time in this moment?
Time is like, for me, time is no longer centering a career, an expectation. Time for me now is I'm like learning to just center my happiness, my truth, my process. And I thought I did it, but I realized I was doing it for a degree, for my family's happiness. And what did SPULU want? And SPULU just wanted to be happy, to be loved, and to share love. And I think I spent 10 years trying to people please, trying to center myself as an artist and not really engage in community and family like how I am now. So now I get to really center family, children, elders, in the work that I do, in revamping what Black versus Blue looked like. All the old pieces that I've done in the past, reevaluating what it means in 2020 as a queer brown person that's just right now at a big shift, a big transition, heavy transition in my life right now, where I'm now having to now showcase to the world that I'm in love, that I am loved. And now that my work moving forward is to really liberate people through the pieces I've done in the past. How can I rewrite Black versus Blue? Or is Black versus Blue still the narrative that's gonna continue for the next 10 years?
What would you like to see come out of this time?
Ooh, I would like to see, I would just like to see like more queer folks, more children, more babies and elders, especially right now, just working with elders and babies now, like we always focus on the youth and our young adults transitioning into careers, but we never focus on our babies. And I think me doing doula work now is just really, really taking the moment to really center the voices that we see every day, but never gets the light that we do within our children and within our youth and young adults. More babies, mm-hmm. Everybody making babies.
Thank you. since I was a child. And one of the main things that I always felt was that this was my destiny. If there was something that you have to do, or something that you feel like you were called to do, this was it for me. Therefore, it was important that I made sure that that evolved out of my soul and out of the reality of my life. And I've come across so many wonderful people that share the same dream as I do. Therefore, I now exist in independence along with those who have come across the hard life like I have.
This is for all the black male bodies out there.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
I got a black male body, black male body.
Yeah, yeah.
Move that there black male body. Move your black male body. Move your black male body. My black male body does not belong to you.
Nope.
It is not yours.
No.
It will not submit under whip or word.
Word?
Word. My black male body's purpose is not to further your personal or political agenda. You cannot liberate me. The idea that you can't contradicts a concept that I'm already free. I'm not a savage to domesticate or a slave to repossess. I am not an underdog because I've been past your test. My black male body's not in prison.
No.
My black male body's not contained. My black male body exists here. My black male body exists now. My black male body exists for itself and because of itself. My black male body is male. My black male body is male. My black male body is intimidating. My black male body is strong. My black male body is fighting you. I am not Martin Luther King. I am Jayson, Damien, Khalil. I'm that nigga over there.
Over there?
I'm indicated by your fear. My black male body is brown. My black male body is tan. My black male body is pale. My black male body is fooling you. I'm not a movement, a waste, or a failed potential. I'm not a weapon, an excuse, or a grave.
No.
I am what I am. I'm who I have been. I'm who I need to be. So I am Sambo. I am Zip. I am Mandingo and I is pretty. My pain is not a canvas. My history is not a primer for your guilt. I am not a magnifying glass. You will not see yourself through me. You can never fire me because you never hired me. You cannot buy me or reimburse me for my labor. I am not an African. I am not a new Negro. I am not a poem.
This is not a poem.
Romanticize yourself. Clearly,
this
that's what you're used
to.
I am here for you. I'm here to be something other than you. Something for you to hate. Something at which you can marvel.
I'm other than you. Other than you.
But I am not yours. But I'm not supposed to be.
Not hardly, not ever, not possibly. Not in any light.
No light.
At any time.
No time.
And whatever dimension, string theory, distraction from the nowness that is me. I am an obstacle, a grudge. An improvisation. An improvisation?
Dation? Dation? Strong.
An improvisation. All this melt black, all this melt black. My black, black melt body, black, black melt body. A 40 years old shorty.
Shorty.
A 40 year old shorty.
Shorty.
Shorty. I used to drink Folkz, now I am 40. OG.
A little bit more about Dazié and Chibueze's piece, My Black Male Body. My Black Male Body is a celebration of the Black male experience. The video intentionally displays tenderness and diversity of Black men, including non-binary, trans, and cis male stories and experiences. Only now, in this time, are we beginning to invite all our men to the table to self-identify. This project would not have happened before this time. Time is a location as much as it is duration. How long did it take us? And where in space are we? Where we can both be answered by identifying time. Get into it.
I will go first. I am Ellen Sebastian Chang. I am a mother, a partner, a good friend, have long, long friendships. I'm a loyal person. I'm a person of integrity. I try. And I'm a theater director and have a background in lighting design. I was a light designer before I became a theater director. I love making things from my imagination, and the imagination is timeless.
Thank you. I'll
go. I'm Starfinch. I am currently the playwright in residence at Campo Santo in Crowded Fire. And outside of writing, I'm someone who is very interested in time. And my work is always grappling with that, massaging that, and finding new ways to interrogate time and see what we can learn from that.
Hi, I'm Britt. I guess I'm gonna say just a conduit now. Someone who sits and feels and siphons, I guess. Time. I guess I'm still trying to figure out my relationship to time. I've been feeling a lot through my writing that then is now. I'm just not sure what that actually translates to into as far as art. So I guess I'm also interrogating time as it relates to how I siphon.
How do you, I guess, define time for yourself?
One thing that I've really been realizing in 2020 is that there's a difference between time and age. I think for me, previously I lined those things up together, but I've had a lot of experiences this year where I would separate them. You know, I think that age is a given, it's biological. You know, you leave fruit out and it's going to be impacted by age. But for me, time is something else. Time can be a portal. For me, time is a lot about alignment. We've seen over and over again this year that things have lined up in a way that have been so surreal, you know, like Trump having his rally on the anniversary, or attempting at first to have his rally in Tulsa on the anniversary of the Tulsa massacre, the Black Wall Street massacre, which, while, you know, just evil on his part, was also a slap to recognize how little things have changed in the attitudes that white supremacy has towards Black folks and Black success. The Attorney General not charging or not bringing charges in the case of Breonna Taylor, also falling on the anniversary of the two men being found not guilty in the lynching of Emmett Till. And just things in my personal life have just, there have been these repetitions that are startling, you know, things that just kind of like wake you up in another way than you were already, and have made me just question, you know, people like to say, oh, we're in a simulation, or it's all a dream, or it's a game. And I, you know, I don't pretend to know what it is, but there's definitely a way that numbers and dates have been aligning that have caused me to really take notice, you know, in a whole different way.
Yeah.
Well, I've always been a lover of clocks, a lover of time. Always been fascinated by timelines, that when you look at timelines based upon human evolution, you can see a timeline where it will go from the Neanderthal, and then there'll be these huge gaps before fire is discovered, and then the wheel, and these huge gaps, and then more progress, and then now, and you get into the 19th century, it's like every little line in the timeline is like closer and closer and closer and closer and closer. You know, it's, there's an acceleration in the human need for progress and progress and progress and progress without ever pausing to saying, is this a progression towards life, or is this the progression towards death? So I think that we've been on a death march quite a long time. And that death march really, for me, really began in the history of the Middle Ages, and when the refinement of time was beginning. The whole clock, the universe is a clock, we go from the natural clock, you know, the circadian rhythms of the body in relationship to night and day. The whole thing changes, and it all, you know, and how the clock became something that was based in efficiency, which is part of what capitalism and the industrial world is about, efficiency. Because the natural world has its own clock, the rotations of the earth, the sun, and then there is human-made machine time. And so that's what, and that's why people talk about CP time, because I think that's part of the bifurcation of the Black body, is that I think genetically we have not completely, and this isn't all Black body, so I don't want to generalize, but to me, I always like to say there's time and then there's the right time. The right time. You know, you go to certain other cultures. I was in Brazil with House Full of Black Women in 2018. And we were it was so clear that we were Americans. And this is a conference for Black women. And it was so clear we were Americans because we would be rushed. And the Brazilians were like, I'm gonna be here. What's your hurry? What's your hurry? I was like, yeah. You can tell the American Black body. And so we are also have been shaped by American time, because American time is about, and let's use one of our greatest crack addictions right now, which is Facebook. The original motto of Facebook was move fast and break things. Move fast and break things. Okay? So I think having a relationship with time means what everything means, having a relationship holistically with your body. Your body. And I think Star's discussion there about age and time is very important. Is very, very important, you know, because I think we mix up age and time. Because I think time is this whole thing that I don't think human beings really have a deep understanding of. I don't think we have any depth of understanding of it. So I'm just going to stop there and let Britt take over.
I think for me recently, I've just been noticing again how then seems like now. And I went to New Orleans in February for research and for Mardi Gras. One of the places I went to by accident was this church on the edge of the French Quarter. And I forget which saint it was for, but it was used when the yellow fever went through New Orleans and a bunch of people. And there were hundreds of people being blessed in this church by the hour. To be buried, and eventually they ran out of space to bury these people, and so they're under the ground. They'd been moved in different places, but I remember feeling like I can't imagine what that must have been like and how people were coping then. And then a few weeks later, COVID happened and it hit really, really bad in New Orleans. And as I was doing my research during that time, I kept feeling like the spirit I was there to contact kept reassuring me that I knew how to navigate through this. I knew how to help people navigate through this, or that she would help me help people navigate through this. And so in researching what people did, what our traditions were to release, to learn our herbs, to grow things, to learn how to heal ourselves, to depend less on conventional medicine, to listen to our bodies and our own timelines, as Ellen was saying. And also just the thing that Star was saying about age and time, I also feel relates to the living and the dead. I feel like we're very close to, you know, I don't know, being on the same timeline or being able to vibrate in the same place right now. The veil is very, very thin in terms of being able to communicate between their time and ours. And that's one download I got. And then the other one was earlier in college, I did this play, I forget what it was called, but it was kind of an Alice in Wonderland thing where this girl loses an hour and she goes back into this dreamland and she encounters all of her shadow beings in order to get this hour back. And that's the first half of the play. And the second half is that she wakes up in a mental hospital and she hasn't taken her medicine. And that's why she's gone through this dream of encountering all of her shadow beings and doing her shadow work in attempt to reclaim this hour that meant so much to her. I don't know what that means to this conversation, but it just came to mind. And then the other thing was, I was reading about this concept of time crystals. These scientists have discovered these time crystals, and they discovered that when they hit them with extreme pressure, with a laser, with extreme pressure, extreme heat, that they bind together and they start vibrating, and the source of their vibration and movement is something that they can't explain. And so again, I don't know how that relates to our time period. Almost, I feel like maybe that we are the time crystals being hit by this extreme pressure, and now we're waiting to come together to be able to move and vibrate in a different way from a different source that is infinite, that doesn't require the need for rest, because it's not draining us. We're always energized by whatever this is. And so those are the things that are coming to mind. That's really scattered thoughts, but that's where I am in time right now.
in love asleep at the wheel. You'll be startled awake when all that hand holding, kissing, squeezing, loving come crashing around the edges of the earth. Each crack another seam to open the floor, rip the rift between this sea and that one, another landmass to lift you away from all that crashing that once was you. All that lull and sweet hello done did drag you down undertow, caught and loving it, yeah, you dove. You swam parallel to shore, you did the damn thing. You let it rise and rise. Here we are, left out to dry, hanging over thin cords not meant to hold the weight of these garments. That's what the clouds do. This drapery of sky wrapped around the only finger you have, and girl, I heard them heels clack tickety-tack down the stairs. I heard that late night sigh, and girl, I seemed to be afraid for a minute. I seen you scurry like there ain't no direction, cause you late and you know it'll be when the clock strikes 10 and 2, when everything between your legs is black and blue. I mean, isn't it true? We the color of a bruise. Here and in between two. In between two petals rides me in the black lagoon. Zoom, zoom, faster than you'll ever go. Trust, you'll try to keep up. Riding on the dune that once was a wave that once was you. Paved but peeking through, I see you. Crawling out of your dark corner, I see you trying for this today instead of another tomorrow. I see you climbing and writhing, waiting for the timing. But listen, when you write, it ain't ever gonna be perfect. So go ahead, get you that pen. Yeah, the one that writes real nice, smooth with a little lift in it. Let's make you dance in shoes that feel pretty. Mm-hmm, a two-step and a little ditty, a little whistle while you work. Cause ain't you working to whistle? Why not make the whistle work for you? Mm-hmm. I seen that little flash of pink you was biding time for betwixt your teeth. I seen that little something you reserve for the select few. We had a special thing, me and you, little hummingbird singing to the water. Yeah, the one that flash flooded neon over your ass. Now you better know what's really going on. She playing you, fool. She gonna show you that blast of shut the fuck up and yeah, I'm the most gorgeous thing you've ever seen. So what? You in or you out? Bitch, what you gonna say? You gonna say no? So yeah, all cool. He slides in, loving it all the way down. Here to listen and learn, cause damn girl, the way you letting it out is like you letting him wash the windows while you inside, laying it down cover to cover, and shit, we about to read, motherfucker. You better get your little notebook and something cozy to nuzzle into, cause girl, when you sing, we can hear you. It's been in the hummingbird's throat, lodged and waiting, harbored at the shore. But when you rise, when you step into the pretenses of human, you don't come back. You see that it's been waiting for you. It's been waiting to not be so safe, so ready for pink rain to release from your sky, making it all wet with the brilliant, belligerent terror of you. And we rise into your belonging, into your insistence in rising through the cracks, and we rise, and we rise, and we rise. Thank you.
I really love, y'all, I can't tell you how much I love the cello. And I love listening to it. And I love seeing Black folks do classical instruments. That shit is so beautiful. I just don't even know what to, I don't even know what to say. So that was Europa Grace out there in the lovely Sudro Bath Landon area, giving us an original piece, Falling in Love Asleep at the Wheel. About this piece, Europa says, the hum of the cello is healing. Yes, it is. It touches deep down into the recess of soul, where rest and passion smolder slowly from birth till death and beyond, maybe. My cello was a tree, of this we can be certain, playing on time as it recreates a new life as an instrument that has held me for over 20 years of my present life. This is Europa speaking, not me. This piece is about love and Black women, loving as a Black AFAB trans person, the complexity of gender and the multiplicity of love and the forms it takes, all somehow at the same time in the same body. Looping cello for me is always a play on time. It is required that the sound always resolves itself, creating a circle, a memory loop, rather than a timeline. Come through, poet. Say them words. Say them. Now, a bit about the artist. Europa Grace, they, them, is a queer, non-binary, trans, mixed-race, Black experimental sound, movement, and performance artist born in Albany, New York, and currently based in San Francisco, Ramatush, Ohlone, Yalamu territory. Grace frames sound as an access point to and from the self, a way to live inside a vibration that communicates more than linear thought can hold. As a classically trained cellist, Europa uses technique to weasel their way past tradition and break free into improvisation, led fully by feeling, memory, and manifestation. Using their embodied tools as a movement guide, they transition the cello from its traditional confines and queer its use. With loop and delay pedals, melodic memory decoded through arrhythmic beats, sharps, flats, and melancholic vibrato. Let me say that with my eyes open. With loop and delay pedals, melodic memory decoded through arrhythmic beats, sharps, flats, and melancholic vibrato. That was and is Europa Grace, who graced us with Falling in Love Asleep at the Wheel. Now, before we go on, again, I just wanna thank you for spending this time with us, for going on the ride. It was really important for me to be able to show all the different times and all the different ways that we investigate time, that we interrogate it, that we define it, not only for each other, but for ourselves. And so thank you for going on this journey with us. Again, that was Europa Grace mindfully slowing us down after the creative queens, Ellen Sebastian Chang, Brit Frazier, and Star Finch got us into this really beautiful mind mode thinking strategy. Really just blowing our minds. You know what I'm saying? Let me not try to do too much. They really just blew us open is what we need. And so we have heard from the fembody folks, you know what I'm saying, the adults. We have heard from the male body folks, the adults. But now it's really time for us to focus on the next generation, our babies, the babies. So first, we're gonna get a little listen in the African tradition of stilt dancing by Prescott Circus with their piece, Higher Ground. Higher Ground, a tribute to the African roots of stilt dancing, is a living act created many years ago through a partnership between third generation African stilt dancer Baba Shaka Zulu and our students over at the Prescott Theater Circus. Each generation of students since has learned about Baba Shaka, what he taught us about stilt dancing, and what contributes to their own moves, styles, and stories to the dance. Their teachers, Sierra Walton and DeMarcello Funes, grow up learning from Baba Shaka and continue to build on the dance with new rhythms and choreography. This piece bridges the heart and spirit of the Prescott Theater Circus children with their various lineages of dancing, tall, overcoming obstacles, and serving others through their talents. Let me say that again. This piece bridges the heart and spirit of our children with their various lineages of dancing tall, overcoming obstacles, and serving others through their talents. This intersection is sacred as offering. It is of this time, but also of no time, timeless. It can't be stopped, interrupted, or snuffed out in any way. Prescott interview is going to be followed by an interview with the Jessica Maria Recinos of Rising Rhythm. She is an artist, an educator, a choreographer, a dancer. She's going to get us a little into the minds of the youth today. And then closing out the show, we will be featuring a sneak peek at the Land of Sankofa, an original adaptation of The Wiz set in Richmond, California, presented by RYSE, written by youth playwright Sakari Wright, and featuring their youth lead choreographer, Aziza Thomas Jr. Take it away.
Thank you. time for it allows it requires you to really sit with yourself and understand it and try to connect with it. Time could be a chance for you to connect with others, to go within, and to really just sit with yourself and to figure out what your purpose is. As far as like definition for time, I feel like where we are right now is what time is. I would tell, you know, the youth of the Bay Area and beyond that are going through this transformation, this tech era, this new way of living, to really be easy on yourself and be honest on what you can handle. There's a lot of information, there's a lot of time to be able to scroll through the gram, to look online, to look at different news sources, to feel very anxious and to feel unmotivated. And I think for our youth to be able to be involved in different extracurriculars and artistic practices that can really help them understand that information within politics, within environmental justice, within you know, equity and inclusion and everything. I think it can really benefit them to be able to figure out what's inside their bodies, like what words they need to say, what they need to express to adults and to each other in a healthy and positive way. Yes, like find those artistic practices and spaces where you can still feel like yourself and still remember everything that you love. You know, I have a lot of students who I had to like text at like 2 a.m. and like people hitting me up like in the middle of the night, like feeling like they don't love what they used to do. Like they don't love to dance, they don't love to sing, they don't love to do anything artistic, because it's like, what's the point? You know, I have all this work, this is what my life is right now, like I don't have time for this. And I think we need to stress the importance of the arts, and that's why it's so important for us to for our communities and our governments to fund the arts, because it really is important for our youth of color to feel important and to express themselves and to articulate how they feel during moments of uncertainty and struggle.
Family, ancestry, healing, and learning to find your purpose despite limitations. These are the words that describe the journey that you will witness in the land of Sankofa. Follow Malkia and venture with her to experience a place that you won't know you needed until your time there is finished. Sankofa is nowhere near ordinary, and in all aspects is meant to be felt. The rules of the land of Sankofa are few and simple. Follow your own frequency and you'll see the places you need to be on your journey of self-healing and love.
The more I dance, the less I feel it. Feeling caught between 4 years of uncertainty and doing what's best for me. Why do I have to decide? If I had it my way, I'd stay here. In Richmond, I'd continue looking out for the broken glass of car windows, abandoned building gallery shows, embrace the pollution in this rich city air. As it constricts my lungs, the waste from Chevron almost distracts me from carrying the responsibility of achieving some sort of success. The more I dance, the less I think about it. But lately, even while in motion, I still find myself stuck wondering, what is success? Do I need to go to college? Because nowadays, the only successful people we see are the ones who get lucky and win the social media lottery, clout over talent. I can't imagine victory smelling the same to someone who has never seen rock bottom. The more I dance, the less I hold on to the hope that God will smile upon me and bless me with the chance to reach it. Like, who do I think I am? Josephine Baker, Misty, or even Tayana? Yeah, right. Truth is, the more I dance, the less I think that maybe I don't deserve the privilege to choose. Maybe I lost that when I heard my mother flatline, and heaven refused to let me take her place, no matter how much I begged. Pain has ricocheted within the layers of my heart before the food deserts and lack of resources took my hope away. My mama died because these doctors didn't believe she was in pain. And I feel like I've been dying slowly ever since that day. It makes me wish I could be like everyone else and smoke the memories away. The more I dance, the less I feel it.
They call me Aunt Shirley. You know, I've been on this earth for 45 years. And with each year, I have grown. And with that growth comes wisdom. And at some point, peace. Now, you need to listen to me. I'm trying to talk to you about something serious. When I was younger, I didn't have the luxury of college. I moved out here by myself at the age of 15, riding a bus from New Orleans all the way to Richmond. I moved with my sister and she was always at work. I turned into a mother at the age of 17, taking care of my sister's children. With the dreams of being a doctor of natural medicine, I couldn't afford no college and couldn't get no Chevron scholarship to go to no expensive medical school. So I learned to paint my own thumb green and work them herbs. Before all these liquor stores, Super Size Me meals, Big Gulps, and 2 for $1 chips for breakfast, we were growing our own food. There wasn't any Kaiser copay and insurance for folks who were trying to build their own. I made a way for myself. I did everything I could to gain the knowledge needed because back then, we ate solely to live. I fought to read the books of Dr. Sabi and other natural remedy healers, which is something you all have easier access to now. Baby, it is almost your time to get out there, make decisions about your life, and make a change. You have the chance to get the knowledge that I spent the better part of my early life peacefully and patiently fighting for. I need you to own that opportunity.
be better than what I was and what I was on the off.
Crazy how fast time goes, right? I mean, we're doing all this conversation about time. Time this, time that, investigating time. We are in time, we're out of time. We are above time, we're below time. We are making time, we are deconstructing time. We are understanding and understanding that we know nothing of time. And yet, this time, with all of us together, is coming to a close. Thank you again so much for joining us. We really hope, and when I say we, I mean all of us at Life is Living, but especially myself and Tierra Allen, my co-curator, really hope that you were fed by this, that you were inspired, and that you felt wrapped up in all of the love. The time that we had with each other is sacred. Each breath that we take is sacred. You and your time are sacred, necessary, and deserving of healing. Let me say that one more time. You and your time and every breath you take are sacred, necessary, and deserving of healing. Please enjoy the rest of the festival. Special shout out to Compo Santo closing out the festival with the Shinaka Hodge, talking about the Oakland Trilogy, showing excerpts of Mirrors of Every Corner, and Chasing Meserly, while also talking about the future and the next steps that's happening Sunday night at 7 p.m. here on Hopping. Again, my name is Ashley Smiley. It was a blessing and a pleasure to come out and host this time with you, be in time with you, love in time with you, ride through time with you, and I hope to see you soon. Much love. Bye-bye.